Give me a chance, Dick. Enjoy yourself here.
Very well behaved, thank you. Sorry, it's not something to... I've got a bit of a cold, so if you can't hear me, then... Any problems or any questions, I'll have to show you, please. So, my name's Andrew, along with my colleagues Lee and Jennifer. Talk a bit more in detail about the market information LMI, how we can use it, a bit more detail, kind of swiftly, what we do. And I suppose applying that to kind of Kira's guidance, which might be some assistance. We'll also look a bit more detail at the SDS internal LMI site, and Jennifer's going to talk about that in a bit. There's also a bit of an exercise, some of the just to get you kind of thinking a bit more hopefully about some kind of LMI and how that might be applied, which we'll cover off, as well as some kind of issues and kind of challenges around kind of some of that stuff as well. So, first of all, kind of in terms of the data, I think that, you know, maybe kind of, it can be kind of quite scary, I think, in terms of so much, and, you know, kind of think that is perhaps what puts folk off in some instances. When we talk about data, we mean, you know, kind of macroeconomic data, so employment data, unemployment data, as mentioned, deprivation, a whole range of things. It's typically what we mean when we talk about LMI. We access that through a number of kind of publicly available sources you may have heard of. So, for instance, the ONS, Office for National Statistics, Scottish Government, UK Government sort of data as well. We also make use of kind of internal SDS databases. So, for instance, Katie's stuff, a lot of that's held during the apprentice, kind of data is held internally. We also look at these departments such as Scottish Enterprise, Highlands and Isles Enterprise as well, as appropriate, to try and build up that kind of best picture, I suppose, of the labour market in Scotland, both forward planning and also kind of historically showing some of the trends as well as kind of a large part of what we do, and help to focus that for future. In terms of who our audience is for, we supply data for kind of wide range of audiences, both internal colleagues and external. So as I mentioned, it's a number of kind of partner organisations. We kind of work and liaise with them. In terms of our external publications that list mentioned or touched on as well, some of the kind of RSAs, the SSAs, those are all publicly available and used both public sector and private sector kind of consultancies, make use of them as well, and data matrix. And internally, you know, that could be, for instance, we could have careers advisors come to us saying, I want to know a bit more about this sector in Inverclyde or, you know, whatever region it might be. They would perhaps come to us in the first instance asking us to drill down a bit more how we can help them with that kind of data. And that's kind of, I suppose, what I want to kind of touch on as well in terms of how we can help careers staff. So, I think one of the kind of perceptions I think that may exist of career staff is part of their function is to provide have the kind of knowledge of labour market information, so where are the opportunities, what sectors are they in, what occupations are they going to be in, where are they going to be, and obviously there's a massive time commitment there in terms of career staff trying to find that information, going through all the steps of actually identifying what the best source. What's actually, you know, what it's actually about, what to know and try and communicate. And so hopefully some of the work we do is around trying to do that kind of work for folk, you know, trying to build that kind of picture up for them to say. And I think I think as part of that, what we can do is kind of middleman for folk. So if career staff need to know a bit more about information, it's there. First call in, I see some of it is internal, we know some is external as well. We've got a bit more detail about the data matrix, which is a kind of publicly available tool that we use. So it's an Excel-based tool. We use it as 84 different indicators across 5 different workbooks. So very comprehensive resource, which is publicly available. And again, this is really what underpins all of our output. So we kind of piece it all together from, I think it's 18 sources we use, we bring it all together and put it out there for folk to kind of to call upon as required. This list alluded to as well, we look at the outputs at three different spatial levels. Local authority level, the lowest level we go to, which has its own sort of its own issues as well. You know, it's perhaps not, for instance, career staff might want a bit more detailed, but again, it's not supposed to be as a kind of replacement, it's supposed to kind of supplement some of what career staff are doing. So, for instance, this isn't just a catch all, this will then help the folk on the ground who have that kind of knowledge of actually where the opportunities may arise. So it's really just as a kind of a backup or to kind of enhance that sort of knowledge. So we typically look, perhaps when we're looking at data we've been from the last 10 years up to the present day, and in some cases forecast 10 years down the line, so 2027 is the latest year we've published in the most recent version of the images. As a point was raised earlier on, the forecast data isn't it's not kind of watertight, it's prone to change, and that is just the best estimation we can give at any certain point in time. What I would say, some of the feedback that we do get, and even just kind of seeing it myself. Some of the kind of what we can actually see ourselves is the real kind of value is in the kind of forecast data, as much as that is kind of prone to change. We can kind of, I suppose, use kind of broad brush generalisations to actually say, well, you know, we're semi-confident given kind of the modelling how that's based, that there will be opportunities, in these centres, in those sort of occupations and so on. But as I say, there are political shocks, which can happen, economic shocks which can happen, which, does kind of play to that. Again, so this is kind of front sheet of one data mixes. So I think right away you can see, there's kind of 33 different indicators in this one workbook. We provide information at 32 local authorities, 14 regions, and 5 city deals, as well as national, Scotland, UK, Great Britain, and some implications. I think looking at that, just as a front, I'd say it might be quite daunting. Particularly if you're not from a data background, or if you've just been asked to go in with a very specific inquiry, it's a case of where to start, perhaps. So I think what we then try and do is try and distill this, try and tap down and distill it into a bit more kind of bespoke requests. As, let's say we've got the specialist outputs, but we can also, we're kind of well placed then to actually deal with any inquiries that come in around about this sort of stuff. And hopefully, as I say, just to try and kind of get or dispel some of the myths around how kind of daunting or intimidating that may be, or just give people a bit more confidence. Actually, this is the sort of information we can provide. So I'd say the data matrix, it more or less underpins all of our outputs. It's the cornerstone for the RSAs in terms of the kind of people, the kind of supply section in there, as Liz touched on earlier on. It's based on information data matrix, which we then go on to talk about the kind of forecast, here's the demands for the next 10 years. It's going to be in these sectors, these occupations, and these sort of areas. So we do that, which is quite a good resource, quite a valuable resource, I think. We would hope, given how kind of comprehensive they are. Sector skills assessments are the same. We're currently just working up a batch of those for this year. And that's, again, also more of a conceptual focus, looking at each of the local authorities in turn as well. But again, one of the outputs of that will be an infographic, akin to what Liz showed earlier on. There'll also be workbooks as well, built up with the kind of key data, so maybe GVA, productivity, employment, those kind of things. And in terms of underpinning or bespoke projects, whether that's Brexit or STEM, as Liz touched on, it all kind of comes from the data source. And so it's just trying to kind of demonstrate the ways we pull everything together and then try and kind of thread that through for folk. I'm not going to ask Jennifer to talk about the SDS LMI site, which is our kind of internal telling resource for careers again and stuff.
Yeah, hi, so I'm Jennifer, so I'm the the new intern for the Living Space team. And I'm just going to talk you through sort of the local LMI tool that's sort of designed specifically for careers advisors to kind of give them the most up-to-date labour market information. So the basis sort of of this part of the presentation, I'm just going to talk about the tool, kind of how you access it, each of the resources that are provided. The slide packs, which kind of the evidence-based team have been working on a lot recently in the past couple of weeks, and then there's a wee task at the end to kind of have a look at it yourselves and see how you find it. So the local labour market information tool, it's a resource that's been developed to sort of give careers advisors specifically sort of the most up-to-date labour market information. And this can be used to sort of inform partnership planning, SDS local planning, and also sort of support the SDS careers advisors. So these are kind of drawn up from the RSAs, and it's sort of the latest evidence on sort of Scottish skills needs at a local, regional and city level. So you can find it at the local labour market information tool within the internal site called Connect, which we use, or you can use it with the, or you can find it sort of the careers information advice and guidance homepage itself, just right here. So this is the landing page for the local labour market information resource, and it's sort of split up into your first two local authorities, where you can go in and you can find, there's two slide packs, so that's a changing world of work pathways, and there's two infographics that are sort of designed on the basis of the data that's given within the slide packs. But also we give presenter notes, so if you go in and you see one of the slides and there's not maybe not enough information there, the presenter notes goes in a bit deeper, gives a bit more information on them. And this is what we find down here. So, slides are there. Is that an issue?
Sorry, folks, just bear with us. Technical problems. Now I'm going to take something to do with this stuff. So I don't know why it's
they're there, just see on the side.
So the,
they're there for some reason. Look.
Hey.
The high slide thing is switched on. See at the top.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Could you be your technical expert?
Oh, yes, yes.
Is this your first presentation, Jen?
Yes, so it's cool.
So, thank you. She's been very cool and brilliant in dealing with it.
Someone's tried to sabotage her.
Where the evidence-based team come in. So in the past 8 weeks, Andrew, Liam and myself have been working sort of updating the slide pack with the new, most up-to-date information that's available from the RSAs that we produced just the end of last year. So the slide packs are designed to ensure that the secure staff have the most up-to-date information, but we kind of put a lot of thought into what makes it understandable, what makes it user-friendly, and this is sort of the product that's come out because of that. So the slides are designed and drawn from sort of a, it's the, you can go and you can choose whatever slide you want. It's not really like a linear presentation, it's sort of a bit specific in that sense. And it's split up, okay, so, here we go. So it's split up into unemployment, employment, and then forecasts. And so we'll take a wee bit look at, so I'll just give you some examples of what the slides are and like what charts are. So this is for the unemployment section. So this is, a comparison of the ILO unemployment and its rates between local authority, Scotland and the UK, so in this case it's Glasgow City. And then we have a look at the employment section. So that breaks down by industrial sector, subsector, growth sector and occupation. So the chart on the left hand side looks at how employment levels in your local area compare with other local authorities. We can see that Glasgow City is just at the top there. And the one at the right, this is a chart that illustrates kind of what subsectors are the most providing the most employment in the local authority, and this again is taken from Glasgow. And sort of breaking it down into subsectors can be a bit easier because if you look at one subsector, it could be the highest because maybe it's due to one subsector, or it could be a breakdown of our smaller ones. So that's kind of why we kind of use subsectors as well. And this is forecasts. So just like any other forecast, it's based on sort of current trends and drivers, but it can change, just like things like Brexit, etc. And this is taken from the industrial sector, so we look at changes in levels between 2016 and 2027, and whether they are expected to rise or contract in terms of levels. So what we kind of do is, from this, we then sort of expect that careers advisors would correlate this knowledge of the labour market with their knowledge of the job sector to be able to give sort of most informed advice that we possibly can. So we're now, task is moved, but we're now going to sort of give you a task. You can have a look at the charts yourselves and sort of, so we get a wee question and we can just answer. But I'll hand over to Lee and sort that out. So thank you.
So, I think I have a slightly easier job here, and then we get to introduce the practical exercise. So, before this, just put yourself in the mind of a careers advisor. You have a client coming in, and they want to go into education. That's what we know going into this. So we've got a couple of charts that Jen showed, and from the slide packs, that give some LMI. So, given the information in the charts and things you already know, how is your advisor customer who wants to go into the education sector in Glasgow? I'll hand these out, give you 10 or so minutes, just do it table by table again, and then we'll just go down the table and see what you come up with.
Yeah, that's the given from the expert.
From what's there?
Just saying that for for the education, but there's not like, there's a lot of growth in that. So I was thinking of personally, maybe I can see that there's growth in the support service part, so I would maybe be saying to them, well, why do you think you want to be a teacher, for example, and maybe take it back to what they know about that, or you know what they're finding more about the self part of the management skills, and then working from there, like, well, what other jobs do you know? Because sometimes I think what I've found is they maybe know what a teacher is, or what, because they're in school and they see that person, you know, teaching it, or their parents might, you know, say to them, well, that's a good job, or whatever, so they don't really know that much about. So sometimes their ideas come from, they're limited, so it's expanding their knowledge and saying, what about this job, we've never heard of that, you know, and trying to like get them to do a bit more research and stuff as well, if they know what sectors are going to be growing.
What about you guys in the
we were supporting the teacher idea, but we were looking more into what subject, thinking about that, like what subject we were looking to teach, what the demand, like what the STEM, the demand for teachers there, thinking about funding as well, how that might impact policy and maybe even students themselves if there's not enough funding to get onto these courses, if we can choose to go into education. So we're looking at the tension between that just covers education, but could be university education, early learning, which can have an impact on the figures that we're seeing in colleges as well. So it might be actually higher secondary school education might be growing, but you can't see that from that, those statistics.
Yeah. It's a good document as well, like you get young people coming in, and sometimes they're always influenced by their parents. And you know, they've come in with preset minds of what their parents think was a good job at the time, and what was there for them at the time, and you know, maybe go home with that and say, well, we'll discuss that, but we also look at where jobs are and things. And it's a bit of evidence as well that we can maybe then talk with their parents about, and then another stage could be, well, if their parents want to find out more about it, because maybe we're all at 16, we're all influenced by what's in the house and things, you know.
And then you guys, any extra thoughts?
Just more about what type of jobs that they're being in education. I know it's broader than that, it's not just about teachers, so support staff or what's happening and sort of staff that they haven't thought about as well. But more of university as well, and the two rooms coming into it.
Excellent, that's okay. So, in terms of just how you found that, is what else can they review? Well, obviously, they gave you just three charts. There's a bit of limitation to what we actually gave you. Two, like, in terms of going to this. There we go. So in terms of like, some of the feedback you've got, there's some limitations to the data. So firstly, it can only go down as far as local authority. So they might a client might come in and want to know what the job is in Govan or Leith or about Bios Rules. You can't go down that far because it's not robust enough, it's not strong enough to give good advice based on that. And the second one, as I alluded to with the table in the corner here, was the education sector, to take as an example. You can cut it right down from head teacher to anyone working in the education sector, really. So from head teacher to pupil support to anyone involved in education. So that's another thing, as you said, pulling out what role they want to go, and is that a good idea, or as you say, start getting to think about other things as well. In terms of the feedback we've got, it's the first year that local LMI site being used by community advisors, so at this stage we're really starting to garner feedback. And some of the feedback we're getting is the value being provided with blue market information. They know it's very useful, they know it's going to help them do the role. And they also recognise that LMI is key to be able to carry out the role. One thing that I wasn't aware of at firm, there's an LMI section with the Education Scotland inspections, so for your peers' regions, which I wasn't aware of until a couple of weeks ago. But there have been some issues and challenges so far. First one is a new product, so with anything new, there's not been much opportunity to gain experience and confidence in using it. So that, that will come with time. It's something that's a brand new product, it's only to be expected. How people, the full range of how Careers Advisor are using it so far, it's new. So we're taking this on board and we're just taking feedback on as it comes and trying to develop it to make it the best it can be. And the more it shares, the more feedback we're going to get. So we can tend to improve it, continue to develop it as feedback comes through. So that's the main feedback and the issues and challenges we've got from it so far, as it is pretty new. So that's us. I don't know if you have any questions around either this presentation or any of the other two.
Just one thing, I've been thinking about as we've gone through everything, talking about like the reductions and things like that. So looking at certain areas where there aren't this growth, could we be only just supporting the figures by abiding by them? So someone came and really wanted to get into the arts and you can see there's not much growth here, so you try to get them to a different path. Is that not then just helping the figures rather than growing different sectors?
Mm. Do you know what I mean? So that's a very good point, actually. That's a really interesting supposition. And it could be. Mm-hmm. What I want you to remember though when you're thinking about the forecast is not just for those areas of growth, but remember I showed you that table that said expansion demand and replacement demand. Mm-hmm. So even though a sector is not growing, when you look at the numbers there for every sector, there's going to be churn. Mm-hmm. So bear in mind, yes, growth, but also where the job openings are because of churn in the labour market. So a sector might be declining, mm-hmm. but if you look at the replacement demand figure, it might still be quite high actually. Mm-hmm. So don't just use gross figures to determine how you would advise one of your clients. Think about the whole picture. So, but yeah, it's a very good point, thanks.
Okay, we'll just say thank you very much again to our speakers.
I feel a bit better, actually. I think it's a positive influence in my own.